So now we'll go back to the characteristics of some of the chemicals. So we are talking about physical and chemical characteristics of the chemicals now. So we are looking at physical properties. From a fate and transport point of view, when we have already set up the problem as what could be, what is our area of interest, what is it that we are interested in? We are interested in chemicals entering water, we are interested in chemicals entering air, chemicals entering plants, animals, soil, sediment and all that. So there are some properties of chemicals that are of interest to in this context. Okay, so which are these properties that are of interest? So straight away, can you what are the properties that could be of interest? If I give you a name of a chemical and if I ask, is it going to be a health hazard in water, what is your first question or response? What is it? What is the solubility? So aqueous solubility is usually referred. So we are going to be in this class, we are going to be using absolute units. We are going to be using units. No, we will try to refrain from any other. We will use absolute units like this, milligram per liter, gram per liter, some such thing. So typically we will use milligram per liter or units like that, even for the. So this is for aqueous solubility. And then, like aqueous solubility, if corresponding to air,
vaporization.
So what's the property of a chemical that indicates how vapor it is? Volatility. Yeah. So vapor pressure or saturated vapor pressure, you can call it whatever you want. So vapor pressure is, we will again give it as milligrams per liter, but you can also have other units. You can, people describe it as Pascal, millimeter, mercury, whatever, so on. Many units are possible for this. Then what else is important? So what are these two, aqueous solubility and vapor pressure? These properties correspond to something. They can be classified as one particular these measurements. How do you find solubility of a chemical? You put it in water and then how do you measure? So if you are measuring it, when you know it reached solubility? If I am trying to find out solubility of a chemical in water, is there a small experiment I can do? What should I do? Solubility, we are talking about solubility, so dissolving. You take a pure substance, you put it into water, it will dissolve. We are trying to find out what is this aqueous solubility. What is this solubility, this number, how do you find out? Concentration. When?
Till saturation.
So how do you find out saturation? Precipitation. No, we are starting with pure substance. If I take salt or sugar and I put it into water and I am trying to find out what is the solubility of salt and sugar. What you are talking about, salt is already there. I am asking you what is the solubility limit based on that. Suppose I take a kilogram of some chemical, dump it into water. What is aqueous solubility? Definition. from a lay point of view, what is the aqueous solubility? It is the
point at which maximum can be
maximum solubility. It's a maximum concentration that it can attain in water. Which means, if you want to do an experiment, how will you do it? So when will you? When do you know that it has reached maximum? It is one constant. Aqueous solubility is one number, right? It's one number. Depending on how people do it, you may vary a little bit, but it's essentially one number.
Solubility decreases with temperature. As we decrease the temperature, we can start decreasing the temperature.
No, at same temperature. I'm asking at one particular temperature, pressure, all conditions. How would you get this number?
When concentration doesn't increase.
With? I think you are going off. So I have a container. I add a large amount of solid A and I put water and I start mixing it. I stir it. What happens to the concentration of A here? It increases with time. The concentration increases with time, and then when will you reach solubility? When do you know you reach solubility? It will? So what happens to concentration with time? It will become, it will do this at some point. So this number is the solubility. What do you call this state? Saturation. Is there another word for it?
Equilibrium.
What is this equilibrium? Equilibrium is defined between two states, between two particular states. So what is this equilibrium between? So we are talking about equilibrium of what in this case?
Solid.
Of this particular chemical A between
solid phase and solid phase.
And a liquid. What is the solid phase?
Solid.
In this case, what is the solid phase?
Solid.
We are looking at the equilibrium of A between water and what is the solid phase? Of what? A very specific definition of this, very important. What is the solid phase? This is what? It is made of what? This is pure substance, it's there is nothing else, it is only A, all of A. You have pure A in contact with water. So it is equilibrium of A between pure substance and water is solubility. So equilibrium of pure substance of A between its pure form and air is saturated vapor pressure. So if you leave something in a container and it has a vapor pressure, it will evaporate and it will come to a point where it won't evaporate anymore. So that will be a vapor. For example, if you put water in a jar, water will evaporate and it will reach its maximum concentration of water vapor in a jar, that is the saturated water vapor pressure of water, okay, at a given temperature and pressure. So these are all conditions for, if you change temperature and pressure, this is all will change, okay. So thermodynamically all these things will change. So we are looking at aqueous solubility. Saturated vapor pressure, two things which are equilibrium of A between its pure form and water and pure form and air. Yeah. What's next? What if I dump a large amount of chemical into water, all of it dissolves? when it comes in contact with air, how much of this will go into air? Now, we don't have a pure substance, we have a solution in contact with air, okay. So, if I have a mixture with A plus water and there is air, how much of A will go to the air? If I leave it long enough to go to equilibrium, so this is the equilibrium between the concentration of A in air versus the concentration of A in water. The air and water are in contact with each other and they go to equilibrium. You allow it to come to equilibrium, what is that number? What is the ratio? So, it is the distribution of A between air and water at a given temperature and pressure. What is this general name and what is the specific name here? There is a general name for this kind of relationship, it is a thermodynamic relationship. Yeah? Yeah?
Chemical potential.
Everything is chemical potential. Chemical potential is what we are discussing, but we are discussing simpler forms of it.
Distribution
coefficient. Yeah. But is there a, for this specific system of air and water, is there a general name? Distribution coefficient is between any two phases, that is generalized name, that is correct. We call it as a partition coefficient or distribution coefficient or one of those terms can be used. Yeah. Those from chemical engineering background, there is a generalized equation, there is a generalized name for this. Lot of this thing is drilled into you in your thermodynamics course. Yeah, yeah, when you look at
relative volatility,
it's equilibrium, it's some equilibrium. What equilibrium is this? It's equilibrium between what and what?
Chemical potential.
Chemical potential is a general term. But it's equilibrium between what and what? This is called a vapor liquid equilibrium or VLE. It is applied in several things, but here, so generalized vapor liquid equilibrium in chemical engineering applications extends to a very large range of compositions. But in our case, we are not worried about that. We are worried about evaporation of components from water to air. In this case, the only components which are going to evaporate are organic compounds. Most of the inorganic compounds don't evaporate that much, okay. Very few, one or two cases are there. And we also know that the solubility of a lot of organic compounds are very low. So, if you look at the vapor liquid equilibrium general diagram, if it is non-linear also, we are now, this is concentration in the aqueous phase, this is a concentration in the gas phase, vapor phase. We are working in this small region here, very small region here, which is a linearized version of the vapor liquid equilibrium. And this small region, linear region where it is in the dilute portion of the liquid is known as the Henry's law constant. The Henry's law, which says that there is this linear relationship is very linear. On the other end, it is called as Raoult's law on the higher end. So, Henry's law, the definition of Henry's law constant is very straightforward, simple. It is a partition constant as we described. So, it is really the ratio of the concentration in air versus the concentration in water. This is a general definition. This is how we describe in contact with each other. This is the equilibrium ratio in which the concentration in the vapor phase and the liquid phase will distribute itself. So, a compound which has a very high Henry's law essentially will, a lot of it will go into the air and little will remain in the water. It will partition itself to that extent, okay. In some applications, the Henry's law is reversed, where the concentration of water goes on top. So, you have to watch out for it. And we'll come to that one of those cases later. In literature, you will find people do all these things for convenience. For example, if the Henry's law is very small, Henry's law is 0.0001, you don't like to put 0.0001. So you like to reverse it and say Henry's law is, Henry's constant is 1000, but it is the concentration of air in A in water over that of air. It happens in cases where does it happen? Where the partitioning is favorable in water than in air. So in places like absorption, where for sulfur dioxide absorption and all that, people use the reverse of it. So